Good morning, church. We're about to begin our devotional service at this time. We'd like each of you to join in with us, for we've come this morning to lift up the name of Jesus. He's been so good. He's been so merciful and so kind. He's kept us up to this present time. And we realize that had it not been for the Lord on our side, we would not be here this morning. And so we want to give him the praise, the glory, and the honor to thank him for keeping us all week long. Amen. 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 That's why we've come this morning. All of you that are here in the sanctuary, all of you that are on live stream watching us, join in with us as we lift up his name. We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have gathered in this house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord. We have come into this house. We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship forget about yourself. So forget about yourself. Concentrate on him and worship him. Forget about yourself. Get about yourself. Concentrate on him. Bow our Father and our wonderful God in heaven. We are so thankful this morning that we have this privilege, this opportunity to gather in this place. And we've come, Father, that we might lift you up, that we might praise you, we might thank you, for you are Lord, Lord in our lives, Lord of all of our circumstances. Thank you, Lord, that we can come this morning to say thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for this church home, this place, Father, where your word is being taught and preached. And we pray, Father, that as that word goes out, we'll receive it, we'll hide it in our hearts, and we'll take it out into a dark world that others might hear it and long to know you as Lord in their lives. Thank you for everyone here this morning, every member of this congregation, every member of this community. We pray, Father, that you will bless each and every one, each and every home, and give us those things in which we need today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you as we go on into the service, that you will bless the preacher, and he'll preach and he'll teach according to what you've laid on his heart. Thank you, Father, for every deacon, every minister, every member of these, auxiliary. Thank you for all these things. And as we continue on in this service, Father, we pray that we'll continue in the attitude of worship. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he scripture this morning will come from Psalms, the 118th Psalm, and scripture reads as follows. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, because his mercy endureth forever. Let Israel say that his mercy endureth forever. Let the house of Aaron now say that his mercy endureth forever. Let them now who fear the Lord say, his mercy endureth forever. I called upon the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and set me in a large place. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. For what can man do unto me? Amen. Amen for the reading of God's word. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Praise him, praise him, praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. One more time. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun unto the going out of the sand, he's worthy. Jesus is worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to. God is my rock. God is my rock. God is my salvation. A strong deliverer. Deliverer. In him will I always trust. Praise him, y'all. Praise. Give him praise. Joys are flowing like a river. Sister Comforter has come. He abides with us forever. Makes a trusting heart his own. From heaven. just so thankful this morning that you love the Lord enough that you would lift your voices to give him some praise. You did it not because of the pulpit, not because of the deacons, but because you love the Lord. And so keep on lifting him up and stay in the attitude of worship right now as we give way to the pulpit.
Good morning, family. Oh, my cousins, how are you this morning? You sound good. Praise our God, praise our God. Aren't you glad to be here this morning? What a joy it is to wake up to the sunshine, come out to the brisk air. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I am grateful to be here. I am glad to be here because I thank God for keeping me over the night, and I'm sure you are too. Thank you, Jesus. May we stand for our call to worship. We'll be responding from the 100th Psalm. Let us begin. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. All together. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his deeds endure to all generations. We'll now recite our mission and vision statement. To introduce, present to all people Jesus Christ through our empowering ministries, by equipping the membership through the effective teaching and preaching of the word to the glory of God. Amen. Let us pray. Oh, thank you, Jesus. God, you are so good. You are better than good. You are an awesome God. We thank you this morning. We're grateful this morning that we could come out to the house of prayer, oh God, that we pressed our way, for we know that when we press, we are blessed. So in your name, oh God, we thank you for the building that we have to come to, that there's heat in the building this morning. We thank you, God, for those things that we so often take for granted. But we give you praise this morning, for we come together to fellowship and worship your holy and righteous name. That we stop for a moment in this busy season prior to Thanksgiving to say thank you. Thank you for the ham or the turkey or the chicken or whatever it is, oh God, that you have allowed us, you have provided for us to place on that table in the name of Jesus. So as we come together, oh God, this morning in joyous gratitude, for this is the day that you have made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. As we commend our service to you today, oh God, pray your blessings and anointing upon our pastor, which will be bringing the message today. Whatever the Lord has placed on his spirit, we pray, Father, that it will be sent forth as you desire. Thank you for the songs, the choir. Thank you for the prayers. Thank you, God, for the word. Thank you for our devotion this morning. Thank you for the deacons that are here. Thank you for the ushers that are here. Thank you for the deaconess that are here. Thank you for the congregants that are here. Thank you for those that are listening on live stream in the name of Jesus. So as we begin our service, we thank you, God. And may your spirit reign in this place. For we rebuke any negativity, any demon that may try to interrupt this service today. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. And the people of God all say, amen. Amen. We'll now have our congregational hymn.
Okay, I think it's on now. Bless the Lord anyway. We're going to be turning to page 309, singing Higher Ground. Praise the Lord. I'm pressing on.
Service, we are going to bring forth Brother Bob from the Gideons that will be speaking a few minutes to us.
Well, let's give Bob a hand. Good morning, brethren.
Good morning.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, brethren, for having me here. Brother James has been my partner and friend for over 20 years in the Gideons, so I thank him and I thank you for being people of God. I want to tell you quickly about the power of one. We speak English because of one vote. German was the other language considered. A senator once appointed by one vote, and one of our presidents, Thomas Jefferson, was appointed by one vote. So one is important to us and to the Lord. Let me tell you how the Lord uses one. A young girl was born in Ethiopia. She had a troubled life. She was disturbed in spirit. No one could help her. An imam of her religion could not help her. One day she was searching for prayer books. She was in her father's study, and she found this, a small Bible. It was given by the Gideons. Her father had not thrown it out. That's not a coincidence. She started reading and felt great peace for the first time in her life. She said, I want to understand what this means. She went to her family. Her family was Muslim. They said, no, we are not interested in that. We do not believe. She heard that there was a health group in town, like Billy Graham. She wanted to see them. Maybe they could help her. No one would take her. Finally, her cousin said, I will take you. And she went. And they taught her and helped her. And she found peace. And she gave her spirit to the Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now she had a spirit of obedience and humility and peace. So when her family refused to allow her to speak about the Lord, she accepted that and stood in that family for many, many years. But through the years, her life and her weakness touched them. And now over 25 members of her family are Christians believing in the Lord. Her mother, her sisters, and many others. The Lord will use one person just as much as he will use 100 or 1,000. He is a good God. Now you have helped us give out over 2.5 billion Bibles, these little Bibles throughout the world. In fact, Brother Jimmy and I gave out 58 of those Bibles at Bayshore last week. And we give them out each week to the high schools and middle school, to the kids. And we thank you for that. We pay for those, and you do too. It's only with your help that we can do what we do. And we thank you. Now, you could help us in three ways. As a Christian, your privilege and duty is prayer. Jesus has opened the throne room of the Father to you 24/7, every day, every hour. Pray. Pray for yourself. Pray for others. Pray for us. We need prayer as much as anyone. Or you could give too, because as I said, we give by paying for these Bibles. But you help us because we can't do it alone. We're on Jesus' team together. So we thank you. And you can join. Men and women are Gideons and auxiliaries around the world. We need more members, though. I'm approaching 75. And, you know, someday I won't be here. Hopefully others will replace me, maybe from your congregation. I don't know. You can serve even as little as an hour a month in one meeting, but you could pray for us every day. Or you could serve every day you wish to. Brother Jimmy is a servant that equals, I can't equal him, many, many, many people. He's a hard worker and he loves the Lord. So if you want to join him, consider speaking with him. It's an easy thing. We're ordinary people doing an extraordinary job for a living Lord who loves us and died for us and rose for us. So I thank you. I thank Pastor. God bless you all.
Thank you.
There's a table out front after the service if you want to really look at that and see in what way that you may be able to participate. At this time, we'll have our scripture from Minister Smith.
Good morning, First Baptist. This morning, the scripture reading is coming from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 9, verses 51 through 56. Luke 9, 51 through 56. When you have it, say amen. If you don't have it, say, wait a minute. I will be reading from the English Standard Version. Are we together? Amen. And it reads, when the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him, who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make preparation for him. But the people did not receive him, because his face was set toward Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them? But he turned and rebuked them, and they went on to another village. The word of God.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everyone. For there's one God. There's many to praise him. So let's not be ashamed of the Lord, because we don't want him to be ashamed of us.
Thank you, Lord. Oh, I thank you. my miracle. I praise you, Lord, for my miracle. You made a way out of nowhere. You turn my darkness into day. So I thank you, Lord. Oh, I thank you. Oh, I thank you, Lord. Oh, I thank you, Lord. Lord, for my miracle. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I said thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
I said thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
I said thank you.
Thank you
for the birds that stay.
Thank you, Lord,
for everything.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the sun that shines.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for my peace of mind.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the Son.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the Holy Ghost. Thank you for the three in one.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for my family.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for loving me.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the sun that shines.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for my peace of mind.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you for the Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the Son. Thank you for the Holy Ghost.
Thank you,
thank you for the three in one.
Thank you,
I said hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. I said hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. I said hallelujah. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I said hallelujah. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I said hallelujah. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
And I thank you, Lord. And I thank you,
for I have everything to you. Come on and give him a hand clap of praise. Come on, church, as God is everything to you. Come on and give God some praise in this place. If he's the sun rising in the morning, your head in your body. I said, I thank God. I thank God for saving me. Now, I don't know about you, but when I think about God saving me, I think about the fact that God did it in spite of me. Yeah, see, I get excited about grace and mercy because grace and mercy says I have what I have, not because I deserved it, but because God loved me so much. Is there anybody here this morning here because of God's unconditional? Oh, I wish I had some help in here. I don't know about you, but I came to give God some praise. I came this morning to give God some praise. I didn't come to signify, didn't come to meddle, didn't come to see who was here, who wasn't here, didn't come to spread any gospel. I came to lift up the name of the Lord. I came because I believed that I was going to run into a couple of folks, Sister Jones, that came to praise the Lord just like me. I came this morning, Sister Lane, because I believe some other folk have been through the storm and the rain. I came this morning because I knew that I was going to run into Elder Goodwin running around the church. I came this morning because I had a reason, a right, and a responsibility to give God the praise, because God has been too good for me to sit down on him. God has been too good for me to sit on my hands. God's been too good for me to stay in my seat. God has been too good for me not to give him, hallelujah, some praise, because God is worthy. God is worthy. I say God is worthy. God is worthy. of all of our praise. Somebody said, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I'd be. But I thank God for being on my side. Somebody say, when other folks left you all by yourself, God stood right there with you. When we even turned our backs on our own selves, hallelujah, somebody, God was right there. Elder Goodwin says, through all of it, God has been right there, standing by our side. Let's pray together. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you and we bless you for the privilege that is ours to be in this holy space this morning. We thank you, Father God, that in spite of us, you continue to love us, continue to forgive us, you continue to empower us with your spirit and your presence. And for that, God, we say thank you. We say thank you, Lord God, because each day we get in our cars and we drive over the dangerous highways and byways. We leave home not knowing if we're going to make it back safely, but somehow, because of your hand, we're able to arrive back to our homes safely, finding our homes just the way they were when we left them. God, we say thank you. God, we laid down last night not knowing if we were going to see the break of a new day. But because of your hand of mercy and protection, you kept us while we slept and slumbered all night long. And then bright early this morning, you animated our lifeless bodies and brought us into the new day, the new existence. And God, we just want to pause to just simply say much obliged. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for being so good to us. Now, Lord, as we've come to this space in the worship experience, where we can hear your word, we pray, God, that you would speak clearly to our hearts and our minds. May your word permeate all of those things that might be standing in the way, distractions, Lord God, that might enter into our minds, imaginations that might be cast down by the enemy that might try to distract us and detract us from hearing and receiving your word. We bind up any hindering spirit right now in the name of Jesus, that your word might flow freely, Lord God, that we would not just be hearers, Lord God, but we would be doers as well. That when we leave this place, Lord God, you and you alone will get all of the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise because of how we act in relationship to receiving your word. Lord, whatever you have to do to me to get your word through me, do it even now in the name of Jesus. Not so that I, but you, O God, might get all of the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praises. In your Son, even our Savior, Jesus' name, we pray. And all the people of God said, amen and amen. Well, beloved, there were a couple of announcements that I was supposed to make. And I'm going to try to do them after the sermon. If I don't, Elder Goodwin's got my back. And he will take care of those. But I want to get to this. We've been sharing with you over the last few months as we swiftly approach the Advent season, the first Sunday in December, on this journey of Jesus from Jerusalem, from the Jordan to Jerusalem. And I want to invite your attention to the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 9, and verses. I want to deal with verse 51. Thank you, Minister Smith, for reading the scripture lesson from the Gospels with such power this morning. But I want to deal with verse 51 because I think there's a relevant text here and a relevant message not only to the space in which we're in today, but also in the development of the church in light of the events that have taken place with COVID. And verse 51 of the text, and I'm going to depart from my normal reading of the RSV, but I want to read from verse 51. In the King James Version, it's not much difference, but I want to read it. And it came to pass when the time was come that he, being Jesus, should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. I want to talk this morning from the subject, a turning point. A turning point. Beloved, at age 15, a young boy who was being raised by his father in the Tar Heel State of North Carolina, experienced a traumatic experience in his life. His father, who he had known all his life, passed away. This experience was devastating to this young man because all of his life, his definition of love, definition of character, even his definition of God was wrapped up in his father. This young man had lived 15 years of his life being raised by a father who was significantly older than he was, and so a lot of his values, a lot of morals and character that he received came from what some people call the older generation. His father was a man that did not express emotions, never said, "I love you," hardly ever cried, always demonstrated a strong presence in this young man's life. The week before he died, after 15 years of never saying or verbalizing the words, "I love you," his father said to his son, "Boy, I love you." Little did he know that that would be the only time that this his father would share with him verbally that he loved him. Now, I need to put a footnote here and let you know that this was not a deadbeat dad. He was not an absentee father. This was a father that was very active in his son's life and demonstrated his love for him in providing everything that his son needed, even when it wasn't apparently obvious that they had it like that. So even though he did not verbalize that he loved his son, he demonstrated it in every day of his life. I tell you this story, beloved, because that event was a turning point in that young man's life. For when his father died, this young man, like Isaiah, saw God. He was able to see God in the fullness of who God was. Because for 15 years, there was no need for this young man to look for another God because he had his father. I share that story with you this morning because that 15-year-old man, young boy, was me. The impact of my father passing was a turning point in my life. It was an opportunity for me to turn my life around. If it had not been for that moment and my father passing, I probably would not be standing before you today as a pastor of the historical First Baptist Church of Bay Shore. I share that because my experience and my turning point is not unique. For if you take just a moment and look in your life, I'm sure that each one of you could find a moment or moments, events that have taken place that has turned your life around. Maybe, like me, it was the death of a parent, death of a loved one, loss of a job, or a major point in your life that compelled you from one direction to another. You are not by yourself in this experience of turning points, because in the life, and even more specifically, the ministry, the earthly ministry of Jesus, there is this watershed moment in the life of Jesus where it's so clear that the Gospels proclaim it as the turning point in the ministry of Jesus. Here in the Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 9 and verse 51, Jesus is said to have turned his face towards Jerusalem. In all that Jesus is doing in the 3.5 years of his earthly ministry, in his miracles and his message, this point becomes a salient point in the ministry of Jesus. Up until this point, Jesus has been performing miracles. Jesus has been teaching his disciples. Jesus has focused all of his energy on the people that he is interacting with each and every day. But now, as it was, verse 51 says, and the time came to pass when it was time for Jesus to be received up. This is the first time that we hear this language where Jesus is ultimately going to sacrifice his life. It is at this point that we see a major turn in the communication and the dialogue of Jesus with his disciples. Prior to this, it is about getting them right. But at this point, it's about getting him right. I wish I had some help in here. Jesus begins to shift his focus from doing miracles to people that they might believe to focusing his attention on what lies ahead. What lies ahead for Jesus is his own suffering. What lies ahead for Jesus is his own ultimate sacrifice on a hill called Calvary. What lies ahead for Jesus, Sister Green, is the rejection of the very people that call him Lord. Jesus has to begin to deal with the realities of the coming moment. And in the reality of the coming moments, the scripture says, and Jesus turns his face towards Jerusalem. What does this ultimately mean in the life of Jesus, but even more so in the life of individuals and the life of the church? That if we take a close look in the historical aspect of the church and even in our own journeys towards our own Golgotha, our own Calvary, our own cross, there are turning points in our lives that compel us to turn from the way that we're going into another direction. Maybe somebody walked out of your life. It was a turning point in your life. Maybe you lost that job that you thought was going to be your career. It became a turning point in your life. Maybe at some point you found out that somebody in your life wasn't really who they said they were. A turning point in your life. For Jesus, this is a turning point, and in this turning point, he's going to face some tragic and trying realities as he faces this uncertainty of a new day. But Jesus makes a conscious decision to turn his face towards Jerusalem. Beloved, in dealing with the turning points in our lives, we have to realize that to turn means that we have to reject something and accept something else. I wish I had some help in here. If you turn away from one thing, you are ultimately turning to something else. As Jesus turns his face from the other villages and from the people and begins to focus his attention and his direction towards Jerusalem and the impending reality and difficulties and disappointments that he's going to face with Jerusalem, he turns away from the accolades, from the pats on the backs and the closeness of those who claimed to love him. Beloved, the uncertainty of this turning point may cause some of us not to make the turn. We're so used and comfortable to the status quo, our place or our placement in our unique niche of society and yes, even in our family. No one want to rock the boat. Everybody want to keep things just as smooth as possible. But beloved, keeping things as smooth as possible, keeping things and the status quo will prevent us from ultimately reaching our destiny. I'm going somewhere. Y'all hold on here with me. We're going to get there. There's some disappointments that come with making a turning point. Matter of fact, when you decide to make a turn for the best of yourself, you're going to lose some folk who have been leeching on you all your lives. Let me say that one more time. When you start looking out for yourself, when you start facing the reality of where you want to go and what you want to do and what you want to accomplish, some folk who have been hanging on to you because of the benefits that come along with hanging on with you, will let you go. Somebody gonna shout up in here this morning, because you feel a whole lot better that those monkeys are off your back now. You feel a whole lot better that folk aren't leeching on you anymore. You feel a whole lot better because you have turned your face, your attention, and your directive towards your Jerusalem. The realities of Jesus turning his face towards Jerusalem shows up as Jesus goes into the village, and the village did not receive him. And the scripture says that the village didn't receive him because his face and his attention was on Jerusalem and not them. Some of y'all missed it. Some folk don't want to be bothered with you because you ain't paying no attention to them anymore. That you are not a priority for them anymore. That you're not answering the phone on the first ring every time they call. Hello, somebody. That you're not dropping everything that you're doing. Stop cooking your cake and jump in your car and run across town just because they hollered that they need you. Some people become dependent on you. These folk rejected Jesus because they realized or they recognized that Jesus' intention and Jesus' motivation was not about them. Jesus turns his face towards Jerusalem. Beloved, I want to share with you the three things I want you to see in this turning point for Jesus. And it shows up in his message, it shows up in his miracles, and ultimately it is demonstrated by the masses. First of all, the miracles of Jesus. Prior to this turning point, all of the miracles that Jesus performed were individualized miracles that benefit the recipients. I wish I had some help in here. That as Jesus walked through and he healed the sick and raised the dead and cast out demons, they were specific miracles for those individuals. But the purpose of the miracles, and the scriptures help this, is that so that the people, the individuals, and the collective bodies might believe that he is the Son of God. These miracles were demonstrated so that they might understand that Jesus had supernatural powers, powers over all manner of sickness and disease, that Jesus was not a magician, but Jesus was a miracle worker. And because of the miracles, the masses followed him. I wish I had some help in here. They followed him, and Jesus later on said, he says, they followed me because of what they could receive or the benefits that they received because they were following me. There's some folk that come to church because of the benefits they can receive, whether it is the deacon's prayer or the choir song or hopefully and prayerfully the minister's message. They come because of the benefits. The problem with people who come for the benefits is that they're not contributing. They come because of what they can receive, not because of what they can contribute. Worship is made better when we all contribute, when we all give something. If you come, hello somebody, willing to contribute, not only will somebody else be blessed, but you'll be blessed because they were blessed. I wish I had some help in here. These people came because they were looking to see what they could receive from Jesus. And when they perceived that they were not going to receive from Jesus, they rejected him. Oh, hello somebody. Jesus makes this turn in his miracles have a different motivation. Matter of fact, after this point, the miracles that Jesus performs decrease immensely because Jesus now has another priority, and that priority is facing his own destiny. As Jesus makes this turn, he turns away from all that has passed and now begins to look at what lies ahead. He begins to say in this text that as he sets his face from Jerusalem He says, and the time, and it came to pass when it was time that he should be received up. Listen at the text. The scripture writer does not say that it was time for him to die, but it was time for him to be received up. Jesus did not see Jerusalem as a destination, but an opportunity to rise to the next level. Beloved, when we begin to look at the future as an opportunity to experience new and exciting things, we begin to turn away from the past, which may include some failures, some disappointments, and some times when we have come up short. We begin to look at the possibility of the new thing that God is getting ready to do in our lives. The miracles that have taken place in our lives now take on new form and new fashion as we begin to face the reality of what is to come in our lives. If we're truthful, beloved, once we get past 50, we realize that there's more time behind us than it is in front of us. I wish I had some help in here. We become more sensitive to our own mortality and the possibility that we are closer to the grave than we are to the crib. I wish I had some help in here this morning. Our thought patterns begin to change. Our actions begin to change. We become more sensitive about how we treat folk because we realize that we have less time to reconcile stuff in the future than we have in the past. I wish I had some help in here. I've run into senior saints that said to me, Pastor, I got to get some stuff together because I ain't got long to be here. As we begin to face the reality of what is to come, and we begin to act differently, we begin to talk differently, and Jesus' miracles change. But not only does his miracles change, his message changes as well. Prior to this point, Jesus and the Beatitudes and the other sermons that Jesus gave to his disciples were literally about getting them ready to be servants of the Most High God. But now he begins to talk about trials and tribulations and persecutions. He begins to talk about his own demise and the fact that he would be going to Jerusalem to die. Later on in scriptural passages, as they get closer to Jesus, closer to Jerusalem, the disciples try to discourage Jesus from going to Jerusalem because they realize that folk in Jerusalem want to kill Jesus. They say to him, Jesus, listen, you don't want to go to Jerusalem. Let's go somewhere else where people like us. Let's go somewhere where we can be accepted. Let's not go into the lion's den. Let's not go in and poke the bear. Let's not go into the hornet's nest. It's not good for you to go into Jerusalem. But beloved, no matter what people say, we have a destiny. Because of that destiny, we're going to have to face the Jerusalems in our lives. We're going to have to face some difficult moments and difficult trials in our lives. And our message changes. For Jesus, the message is now about the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus realizes what is impending is not individualized miracles, not specific miracles for individualized person people, but now Jesus is getting ready to perform a universal miracle. That what Jesus is getting ready to do is not going to be for just one or two people, but John 3:16 declares what Jesus is doing is for every and anybody. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son Jesus, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus turning his face towards Jerusalem gives a message to all Gentiles and Jews alike, to male and female, to black, white, and green, to all shades of the spectrum. Jesus turning his face to Jerusalem includes all of us. No matter what your orientation is, you need to understand that Jesus facing his Jerusalem is a reality that says, I accept you as you are, and if you come to me, I will make you to become a new creation. This reality of Jesus Jesus turning his face from Jerusalem moves not only from the Jews, but to every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl, that you would learn and know that Jesus loves you. The message changes. It's not just about living life here on earth, but it's also about an eternity. Because Jesus suffering, bleeding, and dying on a cross, John says it is so that Jesus might go and prepare a place for us, that where he is, there we may be also. But not only does the miracles of Jesus change, not only does the message change, but beloved, we see in the text that the masses change as well. The masses, the people who followed Jesus, the multitude of people that thronged him, the multitude of people that pressed their way, including the woman who had the issue of blood, the lepers that cried out from the hillside, Jesus, save us, the young man who was in the cemetery cutting himself and being chained, these masses that followed Jesus after they were delivered. Some of them were the very same people that when they got to Jerusalem cried out, crucify him. See, not only did Jesus' attitude change on his way to Jerusalem, but also the people who followed him, their attitude changed. I don't want you to change your attitude. God has been too good to you. And just because you're facing some Jerusalems in your life, don't forget the God who has kept you even to this moment. Don't abandon the Jesus who stayed with you in the midnight hour. Don't abandon the Jesus who wiped your tears away in the midst of your grief and your pain. Don't abandon the Jesus who is on his way to Jerusalem to ultimately provide for you what you can never get on this side of glory. Don't abandon the Jesus who is willing to sacrifice himself that you might have life and have life everlasting. Beloved, I stop by to tell you, Jesus exhibiting this turning point in his life also demonstrates to each one of us that there will be at least one turning point in our life. If you have not turned yet, I hope and pray that this morning that you will see the light, that you would hear the message of Jesus that requires you to turn from your wicked ways and look to the hill from whence cometh all of your help. I pray today that you would realize that you were born in sin, separated, severed from God's love, but because of Jesus, you can turn around today and find hope and peace in the resurrected Savior. I pray today that you would see the passionate Savior hanging on a cross called Calvary, and his words declare, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I pray today that as you face your Jerusalem, that you will realize that there is hope in Jerusalem. Oh, yes, there's disappointment. Yes, there's rejection. Yes, there's trials, and yes, there's tribulation, but there's also hope. Hope because there's also resurrection in Jerusalem. There may be denial, there may be abandonment, there may be restriction and rejection, but there is, thank you, Jesus, resurrection in Jerusalem. You might be at the bottom of your barrel. You might be struggling with the worst time in your life, but I guarantee you that if you hold on, if you turn your face from your problems and your troubles and look to the hill from which cometh all of your help, you can and will rise again. I wish there were four folk in here this morning that can testify that I had a turning point in my life. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, deeply, deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters he lifted me. Now safe am I. Beloved, as I take my seat, if you take a few moments to survey the holy record, you will find that there's not a servant of God that did not have a turning point in their lives. For Noah, it was a flood. Hello, somebody. For Abraham, it was a call to leave his father and his kindred. For David, it was a giant. I wish I had some help in here. Oh, I'm so glad that Elijah had a brook that dried up. I'm so glad that they had turning points in their lives. For Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, it was a fiery furnace. For Daniel, it was a lion's den. But let me ask you this morning, what was your turning point? Oh, hallelujah. Was it the death of a loved one? Was it a cancer or another traumatic disease diagnosis? I don't know what it was for you, and you ain't got to tell me, but I hope you can put your hands together and declare I have a turning point. I'm so glad that the sand shifted and I turned around. I'm so glad that it did. God didn't wait too late for me to turn around. I'm so glad that Paul found him on the road to Damascus. I'm so glad, hallelujah, that Matthew saw him at the tax collector table. I'm so glad that you at some point in your life saw the Lord high and lifted up. Isaiah said in the year that my cousin King Uzziah died, I also saw the Lord high and lifted up. Is there anybody here this morning that can declare, I found the Lord and I turned around? But let me pause for a second and tell you, you can't make this turn all by yourself. You're gonna need some help. And I'm so glad to tell you that all of our help comes from the Lord. He's able. Oh, yes, he's able. The Lord is able to see you through, to walk with you through the dark, dismal days of your life. He's able to deliver you in times of trial and tribulation. Is there anybody here that can declare that the Lord is? The Lord is able. He'll stand with you, stand by you, hold you up and drag you through. The Lord will. The Lord will. Oh, yes, the Lord will. He'll keep you. He'll sustain you. Don't get weary in well-doing. It might seem dark, but the sun will shine. I've come to understand that it is always its darkest just before the dawn. Hello, somebody. I have a witness in here. When you think it's all over, when you're ready to throw in the towel, I'm so glad that Jesus will catch the towel and declare, it ain't over. I dare you to declare, it ain't over. Beloved, some folks said the church was done. When COVID hit, we were confined to our homes. We couldn't fellowship together. We couldn't assemble ourselves together. But thanks to technology, ingenuity, and the faithfulness of the saints, we made it through. Oh, hello, somebody. Sister Bull, we had to do some things differently. We had to do church a new way. But guess what? We're still here. We did it. And COVID, watch this, COVID wound up being a turning point in the life of the church. I need you to understand as I close today, having a turning point is a very healthy phenomenon in the life of individuals and organizations. There's a book that I shared with you a few years ago. The book is entitled From Good to Great. And in that book, it talks about a tipping point. The tipping point is a collection of little events that causes a major change. Beloved, without turning points or tipping points in our lives, we would become complacent. And we would never try anything new. Sometimes God allows things to come to propel us to a new reality. And I think, Elder Goodwin, that Paul got it. When Paul says, I have found, or I've come to learn, that whatever situation I'm in, to be content. Because watch this, I can be content because God is doing something new. He says, all things work together for the good for them that love God and are called according. Hallelujah. Some of us are worried about people who are not here that used to be here. I'm excited about the fact that there were some people who wasn't here that are here. Oh, hello. Listen, don't take it the wrong way. Yes, I miss those folk. But because of the turning point, last week we had a young lady, I wasn't here, but I was watching y'all. We had a young lady join the church that was introduced to First Baptist over live stream. Somebody gonna shout up in here. Hallelujah. She was introduced to the church because we were forced to do something different. And because of what she saw, it compelled her to come to the building. And when she got to the building, she came to the... somebody go holler up in here. God moves us so that we can do some different things. We may not ever know the full impact of our technological imprint on the world. Not just Bayshore, on the world. There were a time in our broadcast that people were watching us from Great Britain, South America, and at least 10 states in the Union were tapping in to First Baptist Church of Bayshore. And some of them are still hanging around. Thanks be to God. They may not ever come to the doors of 175 Second Avenue proper. But some of them, because of the gospel message that went forth through our collective praise and worship of God, caused them, propelled them to go to some church where they could work out their soul's salvation with fear and trembling. Jesus says, listen, just because one group rejects you, there's a whole nother group that is ready to receive what you have to offer. Come on, beloved, is there anybody in here can thank God for the turning points in your individual lives? Is there anybody else in here that can thank God for the collective turning point in the life of the church that is causing us to do things different, to praise God different, to thank God differently, to give God all of the glory, all of the praise, all of the honor that is due him for being God? And being God all by himself. Beloved, I anxiously await all of the turning points that will happen in my life. Because I don't know it all. And Brother Gatewood, Deacon Gatewood, I realize that God is not through with me yet. And there will be some more epiphanies in my life. There will be some more revelations in my life that will propel me ultimately towards my destiny. Brother Bob shared with us in his Gideon presentation this morning that we're not all going to be here forever. That there is an end to the sentence.
is an end punctuation to our existence. But while I'm here, I'm going to do everything in my power to give God the glory. And there will be times in my life that my perspective will change. My emphasis will change. My focus will change. And it will all be about turning my face towards Jerusalem. I pray, beloved, that you too will have these watershed moments in your life where you realize that if it had not been for the Lord on your side, wouldn't be able to walk, wouldn't be able to talk, wouldn't be able to clap your hands. I pray that you would get to that point where you would realize that God has been so good to you that nothing else and nobody else really matters. It's all about God and God getting all of the glory. I've come to understand, Sister Bull, if you give God the glory, everybody else will get what is due them. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and all of its righteousness, and everything else will be added unto it. And Jesus turned his face towards Jerusalem.
Praise God, praise God for the message this morning. A turning point. A turning point. We have come to the point in our service where we extend an invitation for those that may be listening and at this time in their life, they're at a turning point. We thank God for the message that has gone forth, the miracles that each and every one of us have witnessed, even just this day, because you are a miracle. You're a miracle to all those that have come before you in your presence, for your parents. You are a miracle. It's a miracle when a child is born, even though they're born into this sinful world. They're still a miracle. Those that have not accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, it is time to turn the corner at that point. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So as we extend an invitation to that one or two or three that are here in the sanctuary, or those that are listening on live stream, we cannot assume that you have given your life to Christ. So we would be amiss to not take the time to give you that opportunity to come forth and say, I surrender to you, Lord. I surrender. I give my life to you. I believe that Jesus died and rose again for me. And I confess my sins. That's all you have to say. We all had to come down this aisle at one point in time to say yes to the Lord. And I'm not saying that's going to be easy for you. Because if you do, and you walk out that door, guaranteed Satan is on your back. But we have to exercise our faith and know that you made the right choice, that God is with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there one today that wants to come and say yes to the Lord? Say, yes, I want to give you my life right now. For we do not know the hour, the moment. Nothing is guaranteed. The next moment is not guaranteed. You may come as candidate for baptism. You may come under Christian Experience. You may come by letter or by restoration. Just come. Just come. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen to your spirit. Hallelujah. If you're fearful of walking down that aisle, ask someone to walk with you on your pew. They will walk with you. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there one today? If you are listening on live stream, put your information in the chat and we will contact you, have prayer with you, and receive you. You may not want to belong to First Baptist. We will direct you to where you would like to be. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Thank you, Lord, hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, if you are saved and you know it, not guessing, but you know it, say hallelujah to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. We'll now have our intercessory altar prayer with Elder Xavier.
All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. God, here we come. Thank you. Knee bent and body bowed. Face towards Mother Earth's dust and heart lifted to heaven. Because God, we surrender our burdens and our situations to you right now. We fought with stuff all throughout this last week, God. Some fought with depression. Some fought with lack of need and the need of money and things going in of this world, God. Some fought with the lack of health and strength. But God, whatever we fought with throughout this past week, we surrender for this upcoming week of knowing that you're able and capable to see us through all situations. Lord, we surrender ourselves to you, our minds and our hearts and our bodies to you, because you're able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask or think. God, we rest in your we rest in our finite capability in your infinite hands, oh God. Your hands that says you can do all things but fail. Your hands that says I can reach down to the valley low and reach up to the mountain high. Your hands that is not too short where it cannot save, neither is your ear that heavy where it cannot hear. So God, we come to you knowing you're our all in all and you're our everything, that you're our burden bearer and our heavy load sharer. So Father, we come lifting up before you the sick and the shut-in this morning. God, we pray that you would sweep through the hospital, sweep through the nursing home, sweep through those that are bedridden this morning. And God, we pray that by the dispatchment of your angels, oh God, that you would speak to them and give them strength and joy and peace, oh God, as only you can. Father God, we pray and we look toward heaven for our deacons and deaconesses emeritus, Father. Lord God, we pray that you would continue to strengthen them, oh God, that have served on the battlefield for so many years and God just can't find themselves to get to the house of the Lord today. God, we pray that you would speak strength and peace to them, God. Lord God, look upon Deacon and Deaconess Nettles this morning, God. We lift them up specially in prayer this morning, that God, you would lead them and guide them, oh God, and hold them continually in the palm of your hand. God, we pray that you would strengthen every marriage that's in this building this morning, God. Lord God, you know that we know that sometimes marriage is rough and marriage is tough, but God, we pray that God, that with when husband and wife join together with you, a threefold cord is not easily broken. So, Father, we pray that you would strengthen every marriage, strengthen every husband, strengthen every mother, strengthen every wife, oh God, that we will see, that we will righteously run together to see what the end might be. God, strengthen every father in the sanctuary this morning. Strengthen every single mother that's in the sanctuary this morning, letting them know that, God, they don't have to do this thing by themselves, but, God, with you, that you'll see them through the hardships and the despair that they find themselves. God, we thank you that there's someone that we can look to in times of trouble. God, strengthen every father. God, strengthen every mother. God, strengthen every marriage. Strengthen every single person. God, strengthen us that make up this great congregation. God, we're leaning and depending on you, God. Lord, without you, we'd be like a ship without a sail and a boat without a rudder. We would be going nowhere and we'd have no direction. But God, we thank you by the aid of your Holy Spirit that you'll speak to us in our private time, that we might know where you might want us to, where you would have us to be, to do what you've called us to do, to say what you have us to say. God, strengthen your manservant that serves as our pastor, the Reverend Dr. Darius Dixon Clark. God, we pray that you would just continue to anoint him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. God, that as the anointing ran down from the top of Aaron's head, even to his beards, even down to his skirts, so will that anointing flow, oh God, onto your people. God, we pray that you would spark up your gifts in your people today, God. Holy Spirit, some that come to know that they're called to preach, God, let them know. God, some that's called to serve as a deacon or a deaconess or a missionary, let them know, God, that those that aren't here, will, that we know that we have open positions and that those will be filled with willing workers, God. God, we pray that, God, you will continue to forgive us, oh God, for our wrongdoing. For your word says that, God, if we don't acknowledge our own sin, that you don't even hear our prayer. We, from last week to this week, God, we messed up. From last week to this week, God, we've cussed. From last week to this week, God, we've lied. From last week to this week, somebody stole. From last week to this week, God, there were some untoward thoughts in our mind. From last week to this week, God, we did something wrong in your sight. And Father, we pray that, God, as you would hear this prayer, that you would forgive us for our sins. Forgive us for where we fell short of your word, God. Forgive us for backbiting and talking about our brother and our sister. God, forgive us. It don't have to be a first Sunday for us to call on you to forgive us and to wash us clean. Because, God, we need your mercy. Inflation keeps on going up. God, we need your mercy. Don't know what's going to happen on tomorrow. God, we need your mercy. Don't know if we're going to have a job on tomorrow. God, we need your mercy. Don't know if my health is going to be right after we leave the sanctuary. God, we need your mercy. So God, forgive us. Not only God, forgive us, but God, heal us. Because some of us are walking around brokenhearted. Some of us are walking around with our head hanging low. But God, we thank you that your word says that you are the lifter up of our head. God, thank you that when the time of storm comes, that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and there. God, we thank you that we have a hiding place in you, oh God. So God, we thank you. Hey, shall thank you. Thank you, God, for being our all in all. Thank you for being our everything. Thank you for being the joy in the midst of sorrow. Thank you for being our hope for a brighter tomorrow. God, thank you for leading us and guiding us as only you can. And God, we pray that you will hear our prayer. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And let all God's children say amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord.
has God been good to you? Has he been good to you? Oh, come on, y'all. We can do better than that. Has the Lord been good to you? Oh, come on. The more we thank him, the more we have reasons to keep on thanking him for. Hallelujah.
Oh, I just want to.
Is there anybody grateful this morning? Is there anybody grateful this morning? Is there anybody grateful this morning that he's kept you from last week to this week? Is there anybody grateful? Hey! Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. There's some announcements that we got to get through. On Monday, God's going to bless. On Tuesday, God's going to make a way. On Wednesday, God's going to heal. On Thursday, God's hand of mercy is going to show up. On Friday, God's hand of provision is going to make a way. On Saturday, God's going to keep you. On Sunday, God's going to bless you. Is there anybody here grateful that these are your weekly announcements? Govern yourselves accordingly, that the God we serve is able. Hey, he's able. All right. Hey! All right. I don't know what it is, Pastor. We can't get to these announcements. Because you were supposed to say some stuff earlier. Is there anybody grateful that this is the God we serve? As you know, this upcoming week on Thursday is Thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's thank God for Thanksgiving. God, I thank you. I'm sorry, every moment I'm having a flashback of what God has kept me from. Amen. And what God is doing that right now. Pastor's talking about turning points, and I had to start thinking about my own turning point and where God, but I saw God's hand every step of the way. Thank you, Jesus. So we will be having our Thanksgiving worship this upcoming Thursday. From 10 to 11, I ask that you are able to, if you finish cooking your turkey and your dressing or stuffing is done, you done cook the collard greens and chitlins is already ready to be served. Come on by. Amen. Hallelujah. Bring a plate. Hallelujah. The trustee is going to be kind of mad that chitlins is going to be on the offering table, but come on and bring them in Jesus' name. Trust me, somebody in here gonna eat them. But we ask that you please come on out if you can to worship God, because the Bible says that above all, men should always be thankful unto God. For this is the will of God concerning of us. Not thankful for every situation, but regardless of the situation, we find ourselves thankful in the situation. Amen? Amen. And that God has done so much from last Thanksgiving to this Thanksgiving. We can come out for just 1 hour. Amen. To give God a hand of praise. Amen? Amen. If you are in town, or if you can't understand, log on into worship. Amen. All right. And while you cooking your collard greens, give God a praise. Amen. Amen. On December 10th, the Pink Tie Group will be giving out prepackaged meals for the Christmas holiday. Also on December 3rd, the Youth on the Move for Christ, our youth department will be having the Joy of Giving, and we'll be celebrating our tree lighting. Amen? Amen. You know, a few years ago, we started that and dressing up the church in our Christmas, in the Christmas spirit. Amen? Amen. And the sanctuary looked beautiful. Amen? So if you are available and can come on out on December 3rd for the program, and we need some volunteers to help with decorating the church. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You see Sister Tammy or any one of our youth department leaders, and they will give you further instructions. On Thursday, December 15th at 7 p.m., the Eastern Baptist Association will be having their second quarterly session. It will be held at the Mount Olivet Baptist Church in Hollis, Jamaica, New York, on Hollis Avenue, Jamaica, Queens, New York. Also, the Eastern Baptist Association will be having our fall revival being held on December 7th, 8th, and the 10th, and the 9th, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday at 7:30 p.m. nightly at the Hope Missionary Baptist Church. Where our good friend and brother, Reverend Dr. Lawrence E. Mosley, serves as pastor. On that Friday, 12/9, our very own pastor, I think y'all know him, Reverend Dr. Darius Dixon Clark, will be the revivalist for that evening. Amen?
Amen.
So we're asking that you please come on and show up and show out and hope and let Easter know that we got a church over here at First Baptist. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Also, our friend and brother, Reverend Dr. What's his name? Lawrence E. Mosley. Thank you. I'm looking at the flyer here. Is celebrating today his 10th anniversary. Amen?
Amen.
And you know that Pastor Mosley is a friend, not just a friend, but when we need help here at First Baptist, he's always been willing to help us. Amen? And, oh, come on, y'all. When we didn't have a musician, he sent his musician who played here and then went over there to go play. When we didn't have a preacher for one Sunday, his preacher stand here and stood flat-footed on the word. Amen? And preach the anniversary service here at First Baptist. So if you can today at 2:30, please make yourself available to go and celebrate with him at his 10th pastoral anniversary. It's 100 Lemon Street in Central Islip, right down Route 111. Make a right on to Richard M. Loving Street or Lemon Street, and you'll be right there. Amen?
Amen.
The guest preacher this evening will be none other than Reverend E. Jones, Earl Jones Jr., the pastor of the Morning Star Baptist Church in Jamaica, Queens. All right. We want to please remember to pray for our church family, our sick, recovering, and shut-in, and our bereaved families, for we know earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Amen. The youth department and our Sunday school will be meeting this upcoming Saturday at 11 a.m. right after the ushers and nurses anniversary rehearsal. They're going to be meeting right after that at 11 a.m. here at the church on Saturday. For those that are involved with our youth and our Christmas program. Yes, Sister Reed.
I got you. Yes, ma'am.
And Miss Josephine.
I got that one, too. I got that one, too. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. This is a wonderful day, a great day, a chilly day outside, but a warm day in our hearts. We are grateful for our brother Bob, who came and shared with us on behalf of the Gideons. Each year we have them, and we want you to stop by the table, pick up a brochure. I know things were passed out to you. If you cannot volunteer your time, please make a contribution to the Gideons and the work that they do worldwide. Amen, in spreading the gospel message. I know some of you came in and saw that it was a police officer in the church. She's not here to serve any warrants today, so you can relax. If you didn't pay the tickets, you can relax. She told us that the computer in her car wasn't working, so you're all right. We're so glad to have Sergeant Hartgrave with us today. She is here to remind us of the upcoming police recruitment. If you have an opportunity to stop by and just greet her, it is so good to see an African-American female officer. Amen. We're so glad to have her with us today, and we are scheduled in January to have the commissioner to come and share with us again in service, in our worship experience. If you know somebody who meets the criteria, encourage them to take the test so that our police department will become more diverse. We still got a long ways to go, but we need to take one step at a time so that our police department reflects the community in which we live. If you don't know anybody, when you kneel down to pray, please pray for our police officers and law enforcement, not just in the Suffolk County Police Department, but also in the Sheriff's Department, in the vital work that they do in the midst of rising crime, not only on Long Island, but all across our nation. Amen. Amen. Continue to keep each one of them in prayer. On the first Sunday in December, turn to your neighbor and say, first Sunday in December. 2 o'clock in the afternoon. First Baptist Church of Bayshore is the place you need to be. Our ushers and nurses will be celebrating their anniversary, and beloved, we just don't want EBA to show up. We want First Baptist to show up because it is our ushers and nurses' anniversary. I have it, Sister Reed, on good report and good information that there will be an exciting preacher for the day. He's traveling extensively to get here, all the way from around the corner. Guest preacher is somebody who is very familiar to you, at least after 11 years. I hope y'all know him very well. It's yours truly. And we'll be having a great time in the Lord. There will be dinner served. It will be boxed to go. Amen. So after worship, you will grab your box, go home, and eat it. And say, didn't our hearts burn while we were in worship? But we're looking forward to you coming out and celebrating our ushers and our nurses. Beloved, every time we have a gathering here at this church, our ushers and nurses are on duty. Every time. Yeah. 52 Sundays a year, funerals and other events, they are here on the door. The least that we could do, amen, is to come and celebrate them. But not only do they work at home, but they also represent us in EBA and in our state convention. And we want to recognize and celebrate them. We want you to come and show up, but we also want you to come with something in your pocket. Amen. Right. To be a blessing unto them, to thank them so much for their faithful service. Amen. Yesterday, the young people went to see Wakanda Forever. Amen. And I'm going to tell you right now, you can't see a movie, have popcorn and something to drink and some fruit snacks for $20. Amen. I want to thank our young people and our youth on the move. for putting together such a great event so that we, the youth of all ages, youth of all ages, amen. Y'all part of youth department, amen. Came out and we just had a great time. We had the last three rows in the theater, and the children enjoyed themselves. Even the little ones enjoyed themselves in the movie and had a great time. Thank you for putting that together. Those who missed out, sorry that you could miss out going with us, but please go see the movie. Yes. Amen. Amen. We need to support our own. Amen. Amen. Please go and support the movie. Also, upcoming. Sister Lee has worked her little fingers to the bone on the phone and on the computer and has arranged a trip for us to go to see Sight and Sound, go to Sight and Sound to see the story of David. To see the story of David in Pennsylvania. We went 2 or 3 years ago. She has put it together. It is reasonably priced. Please, my brothers, please, my sisters, sign up. It is December 16th. December 16th. Amen. December 16th. It'll be a great outing for the family, for you to go and share in this great experience. Please, brothers, sisters, please sign up. Amen. So we can fill up the bus. Amen. And go and have a good time. Finally, on a personal note, I want to thank you, the congregation, first of all, for your prayers. For your prayers. Right before we went on vacation, many of you heard that Franklin wasn't feeling well, and we missed Sunday morning because we were in the emergency room. But thank God for medicine and medical technology, and he was able to bounce back, and we were able to go on our vacation to St. Lucia, and he had a ball. The sun and the sea air cleared up his sinuses, and he was running around like nothing was wrong with him. But thank you for your prayers, your continued prayers for me and my family. Also, thank you for the loving gifts that you showered upon your pastor for pastor's appreciation. I took some of the cards with me and read them while I was laying in the sunshine, only to come back to this cold weather. But we had a great time, first real vacation in 3 years. So it was a great rest and relaxation and rejuvenation. If you haven't taken one, take one, please. Amen. Life is too short. Let me say it again. Life is too short. Time moves too fast. Amen. If it didn't get done, then it ain't gonna get done. Go take some time off. Because I've learned, and there's many people who acknowledge this, if you don't get it done, it'll still be here after you go. Amen, somebody. Amen. Take time for yourself. The only time that you have is the time that you have right now. Continue to pray ye one for another. Continue to keep each other in prayer. As we move through this Thanksgiving and holiday season, please remember those who are less fortunate than we are. The stresses of social media and society that place on families for this time of the year increases the number of suicides in our community. We need to be in prayer for one another. We don't know what somebody is going through. Amen. And Thanksgiving and Christmas are trying times for a lot of people. So continue to keep each other in prayer. And if you can do anything to help somebody out, make a donation, whether it's dropping a can of food at the local store or at your local food pantry, or calling our food pantry here at the church. They gave out over 120 baskets last Thursday, and we'll be doing more on tomorrow. In the midst of this economy, and food deserts and food shortages, there are people who are in dire need. You have been blessed to be a blessing. God bless you.
Praise God, praise God, praise God. What a service today. I didn't hear too many amens. You getting tired? Thank God for a beautiful service today, and it was worth a couple hours coming out to be a part of this experience today. May we all stand as we prepare for our closing and benediction. We can get our table ready for our offering. We truly, truly, truly thank you for coming out this morning. Prelude to the beginning of the holiday season. As we prepare to receive our offering, we here at First Baptist hold our offering in our right hand because we want to give God what's right and not what's left. For when we give God what's right, he truly, truly, truly blesses what is left. God loves a cheerful giver. So as you come forth to bring your offering and tithes, come with a smile on your face that you are happy and glad to give back to God. He does not need our money. It's an act of faith that when you give, he will give you more than what you have given to him. So we thank you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come forth thanking you, O God, for the offering that we are about to receive. Thank you for the givers, and thank you, O God, as you bless those that feel they have nothing to give. In the name of Jesus, O God, take this offering, O God, multiply it for the upbuilding of your kingdom here on earth, that it will be used, O God, in the way that you would see fit that it be used, that we're good stewards of that which we receive. In the name of Jesus, we give you all glory, honor, and praise. And the people of God say, all say amen, amen. Hallelujah. Again, we thank you, Jesus, for this service today. Thank you for the blessings that we all have received in the topic of this message, a turning point. So we look to you, Lord, as we separate one from another, because we know that we're never separated from your spirit in the name of Jesus. So now unto him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory blameless with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now, and forever. And we all sing, amen, amen, amen. Instructions from the ushers as they come forth.